Welcome to S&C's podcast series, S&C Critical Insights. I'm Eric Krautheimer, a partner in Sullivan & Cromwell's Mergers and Acquisitions Group, and together with my partner, Melissa Sawyer, who's also an M&A partner, today we're going to be taking a few minutes to discuss with you business continuity planning in light of COVID-19. So why is business continuity planning a topic for corporate lawyers? Boards, as fiduciaries, are required to take actions that are in the best interest of the corporation. While one might think that this means that you need to take reactive steps, it is clear that directors also need to be proactive. A line of cases has established what are known as caremark duties. This is the duty of oversight and the duty to manage risk of the organization. COVID-19 obviously presents novel challenges for companies and the world, and how the plaintiff's bar and courts deal with directors' duties in the context of COVID-19 will continue to play out over the coming months and years as we continue to see the fallout from this national and global tragedy. In addition to complying with certain duties, directors will also be under scrutiny from activists who will seize upon their failings or perceived failings in business to promote the activist agendas. Of course, it's not just because they have to be concerned with what happens if they don't fulfill their duties or if activists take sights on them. Directors and management want the organization to survive and flourish, and the steps that boards and companies are taking are understandably designed to achieve that for the enterprise. All of this is going to require a lot more effort from boards, which will no doubt have other collateral impacts. For example, how overboarding is looked at over the next few years may become different and may be under greater scrutiny. I'd like to turn this over to Melissa, who will spend a little time focusing on some of the specific areas where we are seeing boards focus. Melissa?
Thanks, Eric. You rightfully mentioned some of the fiduciary duty and commercial implications of how companies respond to the pandemic. But of course, IR is another important consideration. So directors should also be mindful of how the company is communicating with investors and other stakeholders about the action it's taking in respect of the pandemic. This is especially true now in an era where the subject of ESG has taken on greater prominence in the corporate governance lexicon. We've heard from many institutional investors that they are particularly focused on issues relating to social capital and human capital. And we expect that a lot of issuers' off-season discussions with shareholders will encompass those topics. On the human capital front, the pandemic certainly put a lot of pressure on succession planning and talent development for senior management. Many issuers were unfortunately forced to implement backup plans when senior executives or directors became ill as a result of the pandemic. In some cases, even just planning for the possibility of widespread illness among a management team exposed the need for different approaches to talent development. Versatile employees who could step into a variety of roles as needed were particularly desirable. And this issue wasn't limited just to the C-suite. Many companies also had to look at other key positions. Their IT security team, for example, at times when many of their employees were working remotely. The other big human capital issue that many issuers are facing, of course, is how and when to safely bring employees back to work. This is a topic on which companies will only be judged in hindsight. Different companies and different industries are, of course, taking different approaches. And issuers will need to consider if and how they will disclose the risks associated with their chosen approaches, both to the employees themselves, but also to their investors. Most of these decisions will reside with management, but directors can play an important role in monitoring this, just as directors may play a role in overseeing other types of risks that a company may face, as well as the company's workplace culture. Moreover, directors who sit on the boards of multiple companies can bring to bear perspectives on what other companies are doing, and as such, their insights can be invaluable to management teams. Unfortunately, missteps in how companies handle the human capital fallout from the pandemic could make companies and directors vulnerable to shareholder activists. it's easy enough for somebody in hindsight to highlight actions that ultimately proved to have adverse health impacts, even if at the time the actions were taken, they were taken responsibly and were based on the best information available at the time. Some companies may want to provide a bit more narrative disclosure talking about how they approach these decisions, to make sure their investors understand that their boards and management teams approach the issues thoughtfully and with the best of intentions. Turning to the topic of social capital, of course, this term means different things to different companies. For many companies operating during the pandemic, it can mean the extent to which the companies contributed to efforts to keep their communities safe and supplied with essential goods. Some companies, for example, shifted manufacturing capacity to produce PPE. Many of these actions created positive connotations for the company's brands and boosted employee and customer morale. Because investors are very focused on this topic, it would behoove companies that took proactive steps of this nature to ensure that they tout them appropriately in their discussions with those investors as well, whether by refreshing their sustainability reports or websites to enumerate their social contributions, or by preparing talking points on this subject for their off-season engagement meetings. The last topic I wanted to touch on relates to the politicization of a couple of issues. First, as everybody knows, the early days of the pandemic laid bare some potential issues with the lack of diversification in the supply chain for essential goods, like face masks. As a result, we anticipate that there will be greater regulatory and political scrutiny on actions that further that lack of diversification in the future. Second, the government has stepped in to support a number of businesses that suffered intensely as a result of the shutdowns caused by the pandemic. That fact, together with the massive unemployment resulting from the pandemic, is likely to amplify political pressure to constrain share buybacks and possibly even dividends. We anticipate that the public discourse on these topics could become quite sharp as we near the November election. Accordingly, issuers who took advantage of any of these government supports or produce essential goods, who are considering making changes to their supply chains, and also prominent issuers who furloughed employees who are considering allocating significant capital to share buybacks, should both be cognizant of the risk that they could be called out in a very public way for those actions. Thank you for listening to S&C Critical Insights. For more information on this and other corporate governance topics, please visit us on the web at www.solcrom.com. As always, please stay safe and well in these difficult times.